These are some of the largest superorganisms on Earth, but also some of the least studied. They burn your skin and turn to goo if you try to grab them. It's a disappearing act that tells us something amazing about these deep-sea alien-looking creatures. They're not a single animal, but a chain of clones working together. How does that work? And what questions does it ask about what it even means to be an individual? This is the fascinating world of siphonophores. Hi, I'm Danielle Dufault, and you're watching Animalogic. Today, we're taking a deep look at one of the weirdest superorganisms on Earth, the siphonophores. From afar, some species look like gigantic, segmented, deepwater jellyworms. From up close, they're a series of conjoined clones, all working together, but many with different jobs. Sounds confusing? It is! So let's start from the beginning. They're cnidarians, distantly related to jellyfish, which is why they have such a ghostly complexion. This massive sea monster lookalike is Apolemia uvaria, sometimes incorrectly called the stringed jellyfish, or more accurately, the long, stringy, stingy thingy. It's the largest siphonophore ever recorded at over 40 meters, or about 150 feet. It's longer than a blue whale, and if it was an animal, it would be the longest animal on Earth. But it isn't. This is a group of clones attached to each other. Individually, they look like this. They're called zoids, and they're about the size of a grain of rice. That means that a single siphonophore can have tens of thousands of individuals joined together to make a biological mecha predator. The most amazing thing about them is that they start as a single individual, and the way that they grow blurs the line between individual and organism. Like you, me, and most other animals, siphonophores start as a fertilized egg that grows into a mature body. This is called the founding member of the colony. As it gets bigger, a stem grows. This is the infrastructure that will connect all of the clones. The stem has specific spots called growth areas. Here, clones of the founding member start to grow, but they no longer look like the original zoids. They will grow in different shapes depending on their job. Some will be meant for swimming, some for catching prey and digesting it, some for sexual reproduction, and some for floating. You put together enough of these zoids and you get yourself a ginormous colony. You might be wondering, if they're attached to each other and they have the same DNA, why are they considered individual animals? Each of them has its own nervous, vascular, and digestive systems. If you separate them from each other, they'll survive for a bit, but not for long. It's an amazing feat of organization. The different types of zoids appear always in the same order, making it a truly harmonious structure. Older zoids will be at the back, and younger ones at the front. They swim, hunt, and reproduce together, without a brain to coordinate their actions. Each zoid has a specific function, and it worries basically only about itself, but sharing nutrients and energy through the stem. This modular system allows them to create amazing superorganisms, like the Apolemia we saw earlier. This was filmed in Western Australia by an underwater drone called Sebastian. It was filmed at 630 meters deep, and it was organized in an eerie spiral, giving me some Junji Ito vibes. Some smaller members of these species have been observed at depths of up to 1,000 meters, and there's likely more species yet to be discovered at the depths of the ocean. The tentacles can be over 5 meters long, about the same length as a car, even though they look tiny in this video. Each of them is armed with microscopic needles full of venom. If prey touches it, it gets paralyzed and eaten. Yep, touching long, stringy, stingy thingies hurts a whole lot, but we'll get into the siphonophores you should worry about in a little bit. For now, let's keep looking at some of the most amazing species in the world, like Forskalia edwardsi. It doesn't have a common name, but can I suggest the boa scarf siphonophore? This beautiful species is usually around 1 to 3 meters long, but this particular superorganism was almost 5 meters long. At the front, you can see a little balloon, followed by a series of inflatable chambers that suck in and expel water to give it jet propulsion. The rest of the body is full of feeding and reproductive zooids. This siphonophore is so huge that you can even get close and see all the small animals get caught in their feeding zooids in real time. It looks beautiful and harmonious. But for these little invertebrates, this is not a scarf, but a noose. The feeding zooids will dissolve them, absorb them, and send the nutrients to the other zooids throughout the stem. And how about a siphonophore with a stem so short, but with such a high density of zooids that it basically looks like a jellyfish pom-pom? This is a deep-sea dandelion, a strange siphonophore that feels more at home sticking to the bottom of the ocean rather than swimming around like most of its cousins. This one was seen at a depth of 2,500 meters, or about 5 CN towers deep. These mysterious balls of zooids are very difficult to study, so we're not exactly sure what the little balls it seems to be shooting out are. Regardless of what they are, it's amazing to see a creature living peacefully in an environment that would be absolutely unsurvivable to us. These are just some of the hundreds of siphonophore species. There's a huge diversity, both in looks and behaviors, as they have adapted to life at different depths, temperatures, and hunting different prey. Some of the coolest research we're seeing right now is how they evolve to catch different types of prey. As you can imagine, by the sheer amount of species, sizes, habitats, and shapes siphonophores have, they eat different kinds of prey and have adapted their hunting tools to be as deadly as possible to their main prey. These tools are on the sides of the feeding tentacles. They're called tentillas and are basically bags full of venomous needles. When an animal gets stuck in the sticky tentacles of the siphonophore, the tentacle moves it towards the tentilla, where it's injected with venom. Of course, it's hard for them to be selective about what gets digested, so they often eat their own tentacles along with their prey. It's like if you were eating an ice cream, but the ice cream was glued to your hand, so you had to eat your hand too. It works for them because they have thousands of tentacles, but don't try that at home. Fish-eating siphonophores have thick tentacles and long nematocysts to subdue muscular prey. Those who eat crustaceans, like shrimp, have long tentacles that wrap around their prey to inject in the soft tissue at their joints. Siphonophores who eat tiny crustaceans have super sticky tentacles to catch fast-moving prey. And those that eat a little bit of everything have a combination of these features. So what is the siphonophore most likely to sting us? That is, of course, one that likes the same food as we do and lives close to us. It's also one of the prettiest creatures at the beach, the Portuguese Man-of-War. They might look like glass sculptures with giant satin frills, something that would make a very pretty chandelier. In some cases, these frills, which are really their feeding tentacles, can be 30 meters long, about as long as a blue whale. But all that long beauty is just living toxic fishing net. Portuguese Man-of-War are specialized in small fish, and their tentilla are designed to pierce flesh. Sometimes they float around together in groups of thousands of siphonophores, and wherever there's warm water and large schools of fish, you can be sure there's Man-of-War. As of the release of this episode, there are warnings in the UK and India because of the high number of these cute, venomous creatures. It's a big enough concern that they're being called floating terrors in the news. A fleet of Man-of-War can take out an entire school of fish. And if you happen to swim among their thousands of tentacles, you will be in immediate pain, possibly have a severe allergic reaction, and in some cases, even cardiac arrest. So please, stay away from these cute little bags of poison. Even when they're dead, they can still sting you. But if you do get stung, the best way to deal with it is hot water. No need for vinegar or urine, like it's sometimes advised by locals. They're just going to make you stinky, but that won't help you dull the pain. The hot water breaks down some of the toxins and deactivates any venom needles that haven't deposited their venom. There's so much to learn about these fantastic creatures. So we asked possibly the number one expert on siphonophores to tell us how we're learning so much about them and the problems with trying to study a gooey deep water invertebrate.
My name is Casey Dunn. I'm a professor in the Department of Ecology and Evolutionary Biology at Yale University. And I'm also the curator of invertebrate zoology at the Yale Peabody Museum. So when most people think of the ocean, they think of the coast and the waves. And there's siphonophores out there, but they get all chewed up and torn up in the waves, and then you don't see them, except maybe the Portuguese Man-of-War, which is really amazing. It does wash up on beaches. Most siphonophores don't. So what this means is that you have to get out into the open ocean and then collect them. And there's a few ways to collect them. Even nets tend to damage them. So my favorite way to collect siphonophores is to go way offshore, you know, 100 or more miles or something in a boat, and then jump over the side of the boat and then snorkel or scuba dive. Even though the ocean's very deep, we're not going to the bottom. We're just swimming around in that top layer of water with a bag of jars. And you just can develop techniques to get the animals to swim into the jars. And then you bring the siphonophores onto the boat. And then we have to get them back to the lab.
If you're not careful, they'll break apart and your research is done. This fragility combined with venom is one of the reasons that they have fascinated us for years. You might have even interacted with them without even knowing you were in the presence of an underwater alien.
For, you know, more than 100 years, we've been learning so much about the ocean by going out on these research ships, throwing nets over the side, pulling the nets through the water, and then bringing those nets back up to see what animals and plants and things that the algae are in them. And this has been so important. It's told us, you know, so much about fish and crustaceans and things that are out there. But if you're on a ship and they bring up this net, the first thing that is done with that net when it lands on the deck of the ship is they get a hose and they spray off the net because it's slimy. Right? Because it's been down deep. That slime is the siphonophores and the other animals. They're so fragile, they just kind of turn to goo.
And the research is ongoing. As new technologies are developed, we're not only getting more answers about siphonophores, but also more questions are being raised every day.
One thing I love working about siphonophores is we get to ask these really exciting questions with the latest tools, like how, which cells are present and how are those cells interacting and how does the genome coordinate that? And we get to do that work, which uses, you know, tools that didn't even exist 5 or 10 years ago sometimes. At the same time, when we're out there watching the animals and then collecting them and looking at them, we're doing exactly what people did 250 years ago, which is just observing biological diversity. And I love that I get to do all of those things, right? It's not that because we can sequence genomes, we don't need like microscopes or to just sit with a notebook and take notes on what the animal is doing. We actually need to do all of those things. Like it's not that new technology made old methods obsolete. It's that new technology adds additional questions that we can ask in addition to the old questions that really, you know, might involve just sitting and watching, you know, quietly with the animal and being surprised. And sometimes that's when you see the most amazing things because you didn't even expect it.
That is absolutely fascinating. And as Dr. Dunn said, there's still plenty left to be discovered. All we need is some underwater drones, lots of care, and a keen eye. And lots of protective gear. So what should we talk about next? Please let me know in the comments and don't forget to subscribe. And if you want to learn more about amazing underwater creatures, check out our episode about oarfish, another strange ocean giant. Thanks for watching. See ya!